It's time. It's time. It's time at last. Sicario 2. The day of Soldado.
My seatbelt's still on. We're parked.
Yes, Glasses Films Midnight Review. Sicario Dose, which I feel is for once not racially insensitive or culturally insensitive.
It's not culturally insensitive to speak another language.
Yes. Sicario 2. I am really excited for this, and I have been for like months, ever since I saw the first trailer. You very recently got a little bit fucking excited for this, because
I just watched it today.
Yeah.
The first one.
Yeah. First one's real good.
It was very intense.
Yeah, boy.
Extremely intense.
Yeah. Part of why when this movie was announced, I didn't just write it off, is because the main character isn't the same. Like, the first one is very much Emily Blunt's film. Straight up. It is her movie. This film, it looks to be more Josh Brolin and Benicio Del Toro, with a lot more leaning on Benicio Del Toro, which...
Yeah.
Cool, we're focusing on the Sicario himself.
Yeah, well, and the other thing is, like, Is she in this movie?
I don't know.
I just remember. So now it makes sense. Now that I've watched it today,
yeah.
I heard this like. I guess it's backlash. We're gonna call it backlash because I don't think it's very warranted. Is people talking about how the second movie is like, you know, like why'd they take the spotlight away from, like, the strong female character from
the
first movie?
Did you watch the first movie?
I was like, did you watch? Yeah, exactly. I was like, did you watch it? Like, one, her being, you know, like, a woman has, like, no bearing on the story.
The movie...
I was actually thinking they could have very easily swapped her character with her partner, and it would have been the same movie.
So, originally, it was written to be a dude, but Emily Blunt tested for it.
Yeah,
and like,
I mean...
Fuck, we like her.
It was like...
Let's have her in
this.
Yeah, it
was definitely, like, just pick the best... Pick the person who can play the best, like, shocked... Like, straight FBI agent, not fucking, like, crooked agent.
But also shocked in a very, like, I'm tired of this kind of shit.
Yeah, like a very...
It's a super nuanced film.
Like the empathetic straight man kind
of... Yeah, it's just... It's really good.
Like, she did it really well.
Yeah.
And I feel like it was weird that there's even any complaints about it after having watched the movie, the first one, because it really doesn't seem like that had any bearing on it.
So, this one... It looks like they're going...
I want totally...
Way, way more hardcore on everything.
And I totally am stoked for more of a focus on, like, Josh Brolin's character.
Oh, yeah!
Because you find out that he is... He's got to be... He's CIA, right?
Yeah.
Because the whole point of her character was CIA can't do stuff, you know, across the border without the FBI...
Yep.
And you're kind of led to believe that Benicio Del Toro's character is the CIA guy, and you find out, no, he's not CIA, which means he's got to be CIA. And there really wasn't a huge focus on his character in the movie. Not as much as I thought there was going to be.
Yeah.
And so if they're going to focus more on his character in the second movie, I'm totally behind that, because he was like...
There's...
Borderline sociopath kind of guy. Like,
the biggest thing for me is that it's still written by the same guy, Tyler Sheridan, I think. He is a great writer. Like, he did Hell or High Water, Wind River. He's doing both the Sicario. I think he even has a third one written somewhere. I'm like, he writes good stuff. And I think the biggest thing that this film needs to manage to nail is... how the editing process worked.
That's, like, what made the movie for me. Like, just, like, I never thought just 20 minutes of riding in a car could be, like, so fucking intense.
So, I love when they get to a certain point, they're like, we knew it was going to be this easy. These people aren't here for this. And you're like, oh, wait, what?
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, shit. In the thing that I love is, you know... We saw the trailer, and in the trailer, you see Josh Brolin in, like, a shipping container, and there's a dude, you know, tied to a chair, and you see, like, these rows of, like, giant water bottles. And if you've seen the first movie, like, I'm sitting there going, oh, shit, Nick's like, the fuck are you talking about? Like, and now
I'm like, oh shit.
So
yeah. I'm excited.
I hope it's good.
I think it'll be hard to live up to just how fucking grim the first one is. The first one had, I feel one thing we left out was that whole, he's not a federale, but he's like a state, like, police officer.
Yeah.
And that guy's story was like, you kind of wonder like how it's gonna fit in. And it's literally just there to show you like, just how weird and like amoral the movie is, because here you have a guy who, like, very clearly, like, he cares about his family, but he wakes up every day knowing he's got to go do the or thing at least that he's he doesn't have to do. It doesn't seem like he does, but he has to facilitate some bad shit involving cartels,
and then
he just goes, he just lights out when he fucking gets killed, and then the movie ends with like his family. It starts and ends with his family.
And the thing is you...
And it's just a super grim, like, walk in the line, morally gray story. And I feel like it's going to be... And it was really good. Like, it actually didn't need a sequel.
Yeah.
And but, so I'm wondering if this can, like...
Yeah.
Fucking
and that's
up
part
it,
of the
you know?
That's part of the reason why I'm excited that Emily Blunt isn't in this film. I love Emily Blunt, but I'm glad she's not in this, because her whole purpose is to ride the line and show both sides of the shit.
I don't even think she was riding the line. I think she was very much on the other side of the line, but forced to ride the line.
Yeah, and we have to see it through her eyes. So, I mean, if you're really looking at it, the first film was kind of the first act of what this could be. And that just introduced us to all of this. And this film, I think it's going to pick up and go and
The one direction I hope it doesn't go is like the... Drugs are bad, okay.
Yeah.
And then we get this weird kind of like preachy thing. Cause like, I like Josh Brolin just being like, 20% of the country fucking addicted. We can't stop it, but we can control it.
Yeah.
Let's work with that instead. And I hope they don't try to tread this whole like, but let's try to get rid of the drugs for good. Like,
yeah. I don't think so.
Yeah. They don't gotta preach that. You know what I mean?
All right. It's hot in here. Let's do this.
It's hot. Yeah.
Adios. We're back, and once again, another really great advertisement for Joe's Crab Shack. Eat it, Joe's.
Eat it, Joe's.
Never been there.
Eat fish in a landlocked state.
I mean, to be fair, I did have a really awesome, like, seafood dinner at my parents' place when they were living in, like, Iowa. So, yeah. Stranger things have happened. Eat at Joe's, BT Dubs. Let me fix this. Let me get your beautiful mug in there. Yeah, yeah. So anyway. It was good. It was good.
Solid.
It was solid, yes.
Lacked, for me... Without getting too much into it to start, it lacks, kind of right off the bat, it lacks a lot of the themes in the first movie.
Yeah.
Really just kind of, it's still a grim movie, but not in the same way.
Yeah, it chooses, it's weird, it's like, it wants to be about something very different, but I don't think that, and the thing is, like, if there is a next movie, I think that one will also be very different, but it'll be more tonally in sync with the first one.
This movie kind of reminded me a lot of, like, a sort of, like a Bourne film.
Yeah.
In, like, Mexico.
Like one of the first Bourne film, before they got really ridiculous.
I mean, without... Getting too much into spoilers, it's pretty much just about the government
mm-hmm.
having to cover up what they perceive as a fuck-up.
Yes. Yeah.
And it ditches a lot of the themes in the first movie to, like, pursue that story.
Mm-hmm.
And they do it in a, I'm not going to say unique way, but
very,
not a 100%
the
by
bat.
The books way. Like, there's predictable bits... There's unpredictable bits.
Yeah.
But it is following, like, the the kind of cover-up narrative plus, yeah. like, I can see why they focus more on Benicio Del Toro now, because mm-hmm. it's very much, like, a more of, like, a hero's journey kind of film, as opposed to the first yeah. one, which was, like, we don't know a lot about Emily Blunt's character, mm-hmm. other than she's divorced.
She is meant to be kind of a cipher.
Yeah, first and one. You're, like, looking at, yeah, like we said before, you're looking at what's going on through her eyes, and this is very much, like,
and
not that at all.
I think for this not being directed by Denny, this is as good as we could have expected. This is kind of pitching right in that area.
I was really hoping that the story was going to go in a different direction, but I thought it was too. But it seemed like, I don't know. I don't want to say it's like a touchy subject, but I mean I don't know if we should spoiler alert it, even though it's the start of the movie. But I will hit with a light spoiler alert. The movie opens up similarly to the first one in that, like, terrorist event.
Yeah.
In the U.S. They classify it as terrorism. They imply that another country other than Mexico or, like, Colombia, like, not a South American country, is yeah. involved. And for the first, like, 20 minutes of the movie, you feel like it's going to go in a completely different direction. Yeah.
And honestly...
And that direction seemed really cool, because now we're getting into this whole, like, what do cartels have to do with, like, terrorism? Like, whoa.
How do,
like,
they retaliate?
Like, the post-9/11 world. Like,
yeah.
And they even mention, like, not, like
tighter borders.
Terrorism and, like, a, yeah.
Tighter borders make the prices go up.
It drives up the price of cocaine.
Yeah.
And it almost seems like the movie's going to go in that direction, and then it's like, nope, back to literally the border of Mexico. Like, the movie
It is a place, very hard turn.
Like, super, and it almost kind of doesn't have a lot to do with the story when you really think about it.
Yeah, it's...
And that was really jarring for me for a movie that's, like, a little over 2 hours, a little under.
Yeah.
That it felt like the first 30 minutes of the movie kind of, like, didn't need to be there.
Almost, yeah. And I feel... Yeah, I really feel that what this film needed... Having looked at a couple of Tyler Sheridan's scripts in the past, he writes kind of big. He writes kind of a big idea. And then in the editing process and as it gets to screen, the focus narrows. Like, it's not that we're really... shedding all of this other excess stuff, it's that the focus narrows within the script. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that is something that, and that's not a bad thing. Like, I think all writers do that. Like, very rarely does everything they write make it to the screen.
This is kind of like an hourglass sort of thing for me, where a lot of stuff was, like, funneling into, like, this very concentrated, like, yeah. 10-15 minutes of the movie. And then it spread back out. It doesn't end like the first one, where, you know, they could have never made this movie, and you would have been like, okay, the first movie was great. This one totally does not end like that. Like, they definitely want the next movie.
But with that being said, I want the next movie.
I want it because it seems like the story is going in a very obvious direction now.
And it's a direction I'm excited to see it go in if it goes that direction.
Yeah, I feel like if they do it well, it could be cool. But I really liked the weird, amoral cartel v. government aspect of the first movie. And that's just, like, almost not in this at all.
Yeah.
Like, it's really...
And the amount of it there. That is in this one is kind of like... Well, I understand where you're coming from.
Yeah.
Not even, like, that was unnecessary.
The biggest thing... So, it was a solid movie, but the biggest problem for me was that it was, like... It did a lot of the... I don't want to spoil it, but it did a lot of weird, like, tropey, heartfelt stuff. Do you know what I mean? Do you know what I mean by heartfelt stuff?
Yeah, like, I get what you mean. But it wasn't...
A lot of, like... A lot
even,
of just...
Even though it existed, it wasn't bad... But it was more...
It wasn't bad,
it was more that it was there.
It was that it was there after the first movie. I mean,
yeah.
Like, we watch, at you know, towards the end of the first movie, Alejandro shoot two kids and their mom, and then the guy who killed his family. And then he's, like, a completely different character in this movie.
Because I... When he got an order to do a thing, I'm like, there is, even with certain similarities that exist, I didn't see him making those choices. I didn't see him doing what he did.
Like, this is clearly a dude who's, like, okay with doing some pretty bad shit. Like, he's not a good guy.
No,
he isn't. This movie, he's, like, a good guy.
Yeah. In the first movie, they make it explicit. He is a weapon.
Yeah.
You set him loose in a very pointed direction. And the whole movie is building up so that he can be released in a very specific direction. Mm-hmm. And so when you go into this film, you're expecting, okay, we're going to let him loose and some shit is going to get wacky. And it, I mean... I never thought that it would get, like, action movie wacky, but I was still expecting a little more than this.
Yeah, me too.
And
I'm excited for whatever story it's going to set up.
Because I feel like
I'm excited for a third one, because I don't know. Again, I didn't think this movie was bad, but I think a third one would be better.
Whatever tenuous connection that this film makes you feel like there is between Alejandro and Matt, I feel that by the end of it, that isn't going to matter anymore. And the third film is very much going to deal with... That's not a thing. That is... You now pointed that weapon back at yourself.
Yeah.
In kind of the worst way.
Yeah, I'm definitely hoping that they could kind of go back to some of the themes from the first one if they make a third one. Because it was a bit too pointed.
It did feel a little bit much like that Alejandro was out for justice, whereas in the first film, he's the Punisher. He doesn't really give a shit about... he's killing in the right direction.
When he kills... you know, what's his face? The guy he pulls over.
Yeah.
He shoots through the cop that we've been following as the B plot or the C plot, I guess, for the entire film. And you're like, whoa, wait, what? Like, that guy didn't... He was a mule. He was a cop that was a mule.
Yeah, that's it.
That's the only thing you ever see him do. And you even get the idea that the guy has a sort of, like... aversion to violence. He has that scene with his son where he goes like, you know, don't touch the gun. Like, don't ever touch the gun. You don't even see him touch the gun. And up until he dies, you never actually see him, like, do anything.
Yeah.
And he gets blasted through the chest for no real good reason other than leave no witnesses.
Mm-hmm.
But then we have a big part of this movie, which is leave no witnesses, and all of a sudden... Alejandro Benicio Del Toro's character has, like, a conscience now.
Yeah.
And it feels even more out of character for me because he has so much less to do with these people that are supposed to, you know, the witnesses.
Yeah.
Than he did in the first film, but there's still a problem with, like, you know, the heart stuff.
Although, I mean? I will say, despite everything that happens in this film, the final choice that he makes, first of all, I like the choice that he makes. And second of all, it makes sense for his character.
Are you talking the very end of the movie?
The very end of the movie.
Yeah, well, the very end of the movie. Yeah, and the thing is, the last two scenes of the movie are total, like, sequel bait.
Yes, very much so. And that's why I don't feel bad kind of talking about, like, the idea of a third one, because I'm like... This is very much like, okay, we want a trilogy. And I think they'll get a trilogy out of it. I don't feel like we're going to be left here because these films are also very cheap. Like, I'm not saying, like, they're made cheaply.
No, I mean, just, like, the set pieces are not, like...
Yeah, like...
You're in the desert 99% of the time.
Shitty 90s Toyotas and stuff. Yeah,
you're in the desert or you're, like, in a building. You're in a concrete building.
I feel like this movie had a less of a budget, but not to its detriment. Like, they're just like, we don't need that. We're going with something a little bit smaller.
Because a lot of the movie is, like, takes place between, like, along the border.
Yeah.
It was a solid movie. The editing wasn't as good. Mm-hmm. Like,
you could definitely tell.
Compare the first 30 minutes of both movies, and you're like, okay, by minute 31, we've ditched the first 30 minutes of plot in this movie, and by 30 minutes in the first one, we're 20 minutes into, like, the transporting across the border scene, which is, like, super fucking intense.
I will say, there is a pretty tense moment in this film, and I like the way it was played out, but...
I don't even know what, like, the tense moment was. I don't really feel like there was a super tense one.
Yeah, it doesn't compare, and I think a big part of that, not only Denny's direction, but also...
I think a big part of it for me was that there was, during a lot of, like, the tense moments, there is kind of, like, a weird amount of dialogue going on.
And also the camera work. And that's what I was going to say is, like, man, you miss Roger Deakins in this film.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Roger Deakins is Roger Deakins for a reason. I mean, as much as I say, fuck the Academy, there's kind of a reason why I was... happy that he finally got his award.
I just mean we didn't get as good as shots, like, man, just like the driving through Juarez in the first one was insane.
And that's really intense camera work. Like, that is...
And this one was, like, kind of driving through almost nowhere, and I still don't feel like...
The most reminiscent shots like that were a lot of car shots. I'm like, okay, that's filmed in a very similar fashion. Yeah. But it's a lot of shot, reaction shot, whereas Roger Deakins like, I'm planting the camera here, and that's what we're going to see. We're not cutting until we need to cut, so every cut feels impactful. And in this film, from the very, I mean, compare interrogation sequences... I like the dialogue that was happening. And that's why I say I still like the script, because
the script wasn't bad. That's the thing, yeah.
But, you know, it's almost very similar to what was happening in the first one, but compare just that uncomfortable, like, okay, he's very close to that man, and we're very close to the situation, and this camera isn't cutting, and the longer it stays still, the longer it doesn't cut, the more tense you feel, and nothing happens! You compare that.
Scene literally ends with, like just a top-down shot of a floor drain.
Yes.
And not even anything in it.
And you hear maybe some scuffling of shoes, and that's about it.
Yeah, you don't hear anything that goes on.
And then
you never hear from that character again.
Yeah. But you go back to the script, and in this film, there is a really great... You know, it's said really well. Oh, you think I'm going to waterboard you? Waterboarding is what we do when we can't torture
you. We're not allowed to torture you. We're in Africa.
That's chilling. But then the camera work and the editing doesn't back up the words. And that's why I say I like the script, but there are things that don't back that script up.
Yeah. Solid film. Overall, my biggest thing is like, it's like, solid film. Wish it would have stuck more to the themes of the first one. Mm-hmm. And damn, I wish they didn't drop that first 20 or 30 minutes of plot for the plot they decided to go with.
Yeah.
Because the plot they decided to go with is one of the biggest tropes of the last, like, 2 or 3 years.
Yeah. And it doesn't feel timely because there's no real insight.
Yeah.
Like, if it was insightful,
that's not much.
It's very, as you have brought up a number of times, it is very tropey with what it chooses to do.
Yeah, and it's, I mean, it's a big, like, that plot's been done so many times. I can start listing movies with that plot, but then you're just going to be able to guess what happens in Sicario 2, and I don't want to go get into
that. I do think if you're a fan of the first one, I do think it's worth watching.
It's a solid movie, but it doesn't hold much of a candle to the first one. Yeah,
and as much as I was like, Roger Deakins is so great, this movie still looks good. Like, it doesn't look like shit. It still looks good. It's just, there is a difference between Roger Deakins and a lot of other DPs.
Yeah, I think that if had this movie come out without like the first one, if we kind of, I probably wouldn't have really liked it.
Yeah,
but like given kind of what we know about the characters in the first movie, solid movie.
Yeah.
I kind of wish that, what was his name, Graves. I think it was Graver, because I thought they said Graber a couple times.
Yeah, Matty.
Matt Graver. He seemed like a lot more, I liked his character more in the first one.
His character was way more gruff in the first
one. He was kind of like more of a, like a sociopath.
Yeah.
Kind of like there's some horrific shit going on, and he's like laughing about it the whole time. And you don't really get much of that in this one. It's back to business.
How great was that line of the first one where he's like, "What you doing looking at me? I ain't gonna help you."
Yeah.
And he's just chewing his gum, sitting back, relaxed.
Yeah, or like, you know,
we
got that at the beginning of the movie, but
yeah, again, but that was it.
That's the thing. They ditched the it's like the Atomic Blonde thing where you had this 7 awesome minutes.
Yeah.
And you're like, it's almost like they switched directors. Like, the first 30 minutes felt like some Denis V, dude. Like, I was feeling it.
Man, in like 3 movies, he goes from being like relatively unknown person to me to be like, I'm his number one fan sitting here.
Yeah, I was feeling it. Character, like the camera work was a little bit different, but.
Yeah.
But, like, I was feeling it. I was and and then they dropped the plot for another plot. They executed that plot well, but it doesn't change the fact that
it's still that plot.
We've been seeing it over and over again.
And let's also, with that camera work, going back to it, and the fact that Emily Blunt's character was our eyes for that film, the camera was very subjective. Like, when she's sitting outside of the room, and it's that shot where she looks back, it's, you know, it's the glass wall.
Or like the Juarez one where she sees the cop car.
What I was gonna say is like we see her and she looks back and we see her face, and then we see what she's looking at, and it's Matt Berry's shoes. That tells me so much about his character without saying a damn thing. And in this film, he says a bit, but also I like what he says, but it's just, if you have something, images are more powerful.
Better to show it, yeah.
So, take all this as you will.
Solid movie.
Solid.
Like, I feel like we're ragging on it a bit too much. Like, I feel like I'm ragging on it, but it was a solid movie. It's better to go into it not expecting like the really like grim, amoral cartel v government story that we got in the first one. This is very much not that.
Yeah.
Same characters, different tale.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So next week, I don't know what you're gonna watch. I know what I'm gonna watch.
So, oh, that's Ant-Man and then
Sorry to Bother You. I'm gonna watch Sorry to Bother You. But I don't know if we'll be able
to see it. Like, if it's gonna have the showing.
I hope it's a wide release. I think it's a wide release.
I would rather see that just because I'm getting kind of, I'm not burnt out on Marvel, I'm burnt out on going to PG and PG-13 movies during the summer on
opening. Right?
Like,
oh, Papa blessed me with this rated R film at 7 o'clock where they don't let 16-year-olds and younger.
Yeah, they just don't let them in, Papa blessed this theater.
So, well, the other thing is we might, if we can make the time for it, we might also go see Purge the first year. Because that's 4th of July. That's next week, too.
Mm-hmm.
So, at least Sorry to Bother You if we can.
It comes out on the 5th, right? Because the 4th of July is on a Wednesday.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
You said the 4th. I wasn't sure if it actually came out on the 4th.
Yeah, it does.
It does?
The first Purge comes out on the 4th.
Oh.
Yeah.
So on Wednesday.
Yeah. So we could totally go see it on Tuesday and just sleep in for Wednesday. Yeah. But
whenever, yeah.
Yeah, so we'll figure that out. Either way, you'll at least, I really hope we get Sorry to Bother You Wide.
Yeah,
we'll
get that. Me too.
So.
I want to see Ant-Man, but I mean.
And we will see Ant-Man, but come on, sometimes we got to rep the little guys.
Like, we all know it's not going to suck ass, probably.
Yeah.
We'll give you a pre-review review. It's not going to suck ass. Probably all right.
Sorry to Bother You. Man, I don't want to sound like a trailer quote, but this looks like a bold new voice in American cinema.
Wow! Fuck off.
So
it looks funny.
Yeah,
I'm gonna say that bold new voice in America.
I know. I hate that.
I'm just a sucker for. I think David Cross is fucking hilarious. So, like, I'll watch anything with David Cross.
And Lakeith Stanfield. I feel like I'm saying his name wrong. I like him. I like him and everything I've seen him in. So, please like this video, subscribe to the channel, youtube.com/glasshousefilms, facebook.com/glassesfilms, and Twitter @glassesfilms. Thanks, y'all, and we'll see you next week. Bye.